मॉर्निंग, माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर वर्षा रानी, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ क्रॉप फिजियोलॉजी, बिरसा एग्रीकल्चर यूनिवर्सिटी रांची. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अ न्यू ग्रुप ऑफ हार्मोन, दैट इज जिबरलिन एंड साइटोकाइन. सो एज डिस्कस्ड अर्लियर, द प्लांट हार्मोन्स आर डिवाइडेड इनटू टू ग्रुप्स, दैट इज ग्रोथ प्रोमोटर एंड ग्रोथ इनहिबिटर. द ग्रोथ प्रोमोटर्स आर ऑक्सिन, जिबरलिन एंड साइटोकाइन, एंड ग्रोथ इनहिबिटर्स आर इथिलीन एंड एब्सिसिक एसिड. So the next, after cytokinin, the next growth promoter which was characterized was gibberellin. So today I will start the new topic, that is gibberellin. So gibberellin was characterized by rice farmers which were growing rice in Japan, and they observed that few group of rice seedling grew abnormally tall, and they termed it as foolish seedling disease or Buckner disease. So later rice pathologists worked upon it, and they isolated Gibberella pyogeri, a pathogenic fungi, from those abnormally grown seedling, and they crystallized group of chemicals from that. And because it was secreted by Gibberella pyogeri, that's why it was named gibberellin A. So this gibberellin which was isolated from the culture filtrate of Gibberella were having a group of chemicals, but the principal component which was obtained from culture filtrate was gibberellin 3, GA3, and this GA3 is mainly responsible for internodal elongation. Besides gibberellin GA3, there are other gibberellins which are responsible for internodal elongation, that is GA1, GA3, GA4 and GA7, while GA5 is responsible for flowering in response in plants. Now, what is the site of gibberellin biosynthesis in plants? Since GA, when I will discuss about the biosynthetic pathway of gibberellin, I will let you know, I will discuss that the gibberellin biosynthesis is completed in three cellular compartments, that is plastid, endoplasmic reticulum and cytosol. So as I told that it is synthesized in one of the cellular compartment, that is plastid. The most important or the primary site of gibberellin biosynthesis is young leaf. Beside that, it is synthesized in roots, developing seeds and fruits also. Now, what is the mode of transport of gibberellin in plant? Unlike auxin, it is non-polar, its transport is non-polar in nature, and since it is non-polar in nature, it is transported through via xylem or phloem, any of the two. While auxin is synthesized, it is transported through phloem in plant, and it is bicipital, it is non-polar in nature. But it is not the case in case of gibberellin. It is non-polar in nature, and it may get transported through xylem as well as through phloem. So now coming to gibberellin, the most important response, the most important physiological response or developmental role is stem elongation, or this elongation takes place in internodal region, because of which the whole plant gets elongated in height. Now coming to the chemistry of gibberellin, gibberellin is biosynthesized through terpenoid pathway, and it is basically a cyclic diterpene, and it is made up of four isoprene units. Its chemical formula is C19H22 and O6. Now coming to biosynthesis of gibberellin, so the biosynthesis of gibberellin is completed in three stages and in three different compartments, that is plastid, endoplasmic reticulum and cytosol. So here in this figure you can see that the precursor of gibberellin is GGPP, that is geraniol diphosphate, and this geraniol diphosphate is converted to N-taurine in the plastid through N-copalyl diphosphate. So how this GGP is synthesized, how this geraniol diphosphate is synthesized? It is synthesized from IPP, that is isopentanyl diphosphate, and this isopentanyl diphosphate may synthesized by two pathways, that is mevalonic acid dependent pathway and mevalonic acid non-dependent pathway. When we discuss about mevalonic acid dependent pathway, then the precursor of GGPP, the precursor of IPP is glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and pyruvate, and in case of mevalonic acid non-dependent pathway, the IPP is synthesized from acetyl coenzyme A. So either of the two pathways lead to the formation of GGPP, and when GGPP is synthesized, when geraniol diphosphate is synthesized, it will be committed for the synthesis of gibberellin. Means after this, the pathway will go for the formation of gibberellin. So in the first cellular compartment, that is plastid, GGPP will get converted into N-taurin through N-copalyl diphosphate, and this N-taurin will enter for the next stage of biosynthesis in the next compartment, that is endoplasmic reticulum. from in the endoplasmic reticulum in the ER, the end corium will be converted to GA12 and GA53 by the formation of GA12 aldehyde as intermediate, and here there will be involvement of enzyme that is monooxygenase. It uses the phytochrome P450, that's why it is called as P450 monooxygenase. So I would like to tell you the inhibitor of these two steps. So this particular step, that is the first step, which takes place in plastid, get inhibited by three inhibitors, three GA biosynthetic inhibitors, that is phosphone D, AMO1618 and CCC, that is cyclosine. So any of these three inhibitors may lead to the inhibition of this gibberellin biosynthesis. In the next stage, what happens, the inhibitor is paclobutazole. So this paclobutazole inhibitor will inhibit the gibberellin biosynthesis by inhibiting the activity of monooxygenase enzyme. Now the third stage of this GA biosynthesis will be completed in cytosol, and here what happens, this GA12 or GA53 will be converted into GA20 by using the enzyme GA20 oxidase. It will be converted to GA20, and this GA20 will then be converted to GA1, and GA1 is the first active gibberellin which will be synthesized through this pathway, and from GA1 only other gibberellin will be synthesized. So after its biosynthesis, how gibberellin exerts its effect, what is the mode of action of gibberellin in plant, how gibberellin exerts its action, or what is the mechanism of GA action. Gibberellin exerts its effect mainly in the intercalary meristem. Here the intercalary meristem, which is just above the base, which is just above the node, here what happens, along with auxin, gibberellin exerts its effect. So auxin will lead to the will lead to elongation of the cell, and by acid hypothesis mechanism, So gibberellin causes its action, gibberellin exerts its action along with auxin. Here auxin will lead to the elongation of the cell by acid growth hypothesis, and gibberellin will cause cell division. So how gibberellin causes cell division, how gibberellin increases the rate of cell division, it stimulates CDKs, and because of this, what happens, the cell enters rapidly from G1 phase to S phase and from S phase to G2 phase. So by accelerating this transition from G1 to S and from S to G2, there is increased mitosis, there is increased cell division, and because of this increased cell division and because of this cell elongation due to the combined action of both auxin and gibberellin, there will be increased mitosis, increased cell division in this region, and also there will be orientation. There will be orientation of these microtubules, and they will orient towards the longitudinal portion. And as a result of all this action, what will happen? There will be internodal elongation, and the plant will grow in height. Now, this internodal elongation in rosette plant is known as bolting. So what happens, gibberellin induces stem elongation in rosette plant. So first of all, what is rosette plant? So in rosette plant, like cabbage is a rosette species, in cabbage the first formed internode gets suppressed, and because of which the leaves appear close to each other and they form a rosette like structure or rosette like appearance, and this is called as rosette plant, rosette species or rosette plant. Rosette condition, and this rosette condition is mainly take place when any long day plant is grown under short day condition. But here you can see, in this figure you can see, these are the rosette leaves. Here they are clustered in the internode, in the first form internode, and when there is application of gibberellin, then there will be internodal elongation and the leaves will spread from each other, and it will take the form of the tallest variety of the species. So this particular internodal elongation in rosette species in presence of gibberellin is known as bolting. Beside this, the next physiological role of gibberellin is it breaks seed dormancy. So gibberellin substitute for cold low temperature requirement by the seed of the plants, by the seed of the species which require low temperature. and gibberellin substitute for low temperature and therefore causes the seed to germinate. It breaks seed dormancy. Here is the list of short day plant, long day plant and day neutral plant for your information, and by going through it you can know that the gibberellin substitute for long day requirement in long day plants for germination. Also, gibberellin promotes floral initiation. It induces flower in the plants. So what happens, it is substitute for low temperature requirement for flowering in plant, which is known as vernalization. So this cold signal induces vernalization, and if GA is provided, it will substitute for it and it will lead to the formation of floral initiation in the plant. Here in this figure also you can see that for the transition of vegetative plant into the reproductive stage, there is requirement of some plant hormone, photoperiod, quality of light and temperature. So these four are important determining factors which is responsible for transition from vegetative to reproductive stage, and gibberellin is one of them, one of the plant hormone which substitute for low temperature or long day period for flowering to take place. Now is the next role of gibberellin is in malting of barley. In brewing process, what happens, we have to germinate the seeds of barley very rapidly. Here the role of gibberellin take place. What happens in the embryo, when the seed is dormant, the gibberellin is present in bound form, but when the seed obtain optimum moisture, temperature, light and all the favorable condition for germination to take place, then what happens, then gibberellin becomes free, gibberellin gets free and the embryo releases the gibberellin and it goes to endosperm through scutellum. It diffuses through scutellum to the endosperm. So endosperm has reserve of food material in it. So what happens, from here it will diffuse into the aleurone layer, and this aleurone layer will get stimulated for the synthesis and secretion of hydrolytic enzymes like alpha amylase especially. So alpha amylase will be induced by the aleurone layer and it will be synthesized and secreted in the endosperm. In endosperm, the macromolecules are present like carbohydrates or proteins. So in response to alpha amylase, the carbohydrates or any complex molecule, organic molecule, will be broken down into simpler molecule, and from there this simpler molecule will again diffuse through scutellum into the embryo, and this food material will supply, the simpler food material will provide energy to the germinating seed. So gibberellin, what happens, this gibberellin accelerates the or causes the seed to germinate faster, and that's why this character of gibberellin is used for the malting of barley. Beside this, the practical application of gibberellin is to increase the yield of sugarcane. How it increases the yield of sugarcane? Gibberellin doesn't act alone, it acts along with the in combination with ethyl. Here in this photograph you can see, here in this slide you can see that exogenous application of ethyl along with gibberellin increases the yield of sugarcane. So ethyl increases the sprouting of sugarcane. Means when we are using sugarcane as a seed, then the ethyl will cause a sprouting of maximum number of buds, and after that what happens, gibberellin will cause internodal elongation and increase in girth of the sugarcane, and also it will increase the quantity of sucrose. So the overall effect will be the higher yield of the sugarcane. Beside this, what happens, gibberellin induces the transition from juvenile to adult phase. So what is juvenile phase? Juvenile phase means many woody perennials. They require a certain stage of maturity to enter into the reproductive phase. This particular period is known as juvenile period. After that they will produce cone or flower. So and what is vegetative phase? One is juvenile phase and one is vegetative phase. So vegetative phase is the period of growth or the period before reproductive phase in plant is termed as vegetative phase, while juvenile phase is the certain phase of maturity after which the plant will produce cone or flower. So here we are taking the example of Hedera helix, that is English ivy. So English ivy has two different phases, that is juvenile phase and mature phase, maturity phase. So in juvenile phase the plant is in the form of vine, climber, and the characteristic morphology of leaf will be lobed. Here you can see in the figure the morphology of the leaf is lobed, while the when it will enter into the phase of maturity, what will happen? The plant will take the form of erect shrub, and its leaf, the morphology of the leaf will be normal. It will be round, not lobed, simple. The leaves will become simple. So during the transition or after the transition from juvenile to mature phase, there will be characteristic change in the morphology of the leaf of heterohelix. So what happens? Gibberellin causes transition. It induces transition from juvenile to adult phase. Or what happens? It may stop the application, exogenous application of gibberellin stops the mature phase of heterohelix to produce flower or cone. What will happen? It will cause the sprouting of buds from the lower portion of the stem, and there will be formation of new vegetative parts, new juvenile phase. And by this, it regulates the transition from juvenile to adult phase. A very important commercial cash crop, that is jackfruit. So how long does it take a seedling jackfruit to bear fruits? Jackfruit bear fruits or flower after 12 to 14 years. So the juvenile phase of jackfruit is very large, 12 to 14 years. So this much of juvenile, this longer juvenile period is not remunerative for the farmers. That's why by the application of gibberellin, we can reduce the juvenile phase of jackfruit to little lower, up to the 8 to 9 years we can reduce. Means the after application of gibberellin, the jackfruit may bear flower or fruit after 8 to 9 years of its seedling stage. So why the jackfruit is having so longer juvenile phase? Because it has to produce large number of fruits, and the fruits are very big in size. So in order to bear such large fruits and such large number of fruits in the tree, on the tree, the tree has to prepare itself. Means that's why the juvenile phase is very longer in case of jackfruit. But by application of gibberellin, we can reduce the juvenile phase up to 8 to 9 years. Now the next important role, commercial application of gibberellin, is that it improves the berry size of Thomson seedless grapes. So here in this figure you can see that this is the bunch of grape, Thomson seedless grape, before application of gibberellin, and this is after the application of gibberellin. What happens? Gibberellin causes the increase in length of the stalk of the grapes. So when gibberellin is not applied, the stalk length is short, and the berries are attached to it in a compact cluster, forming a compact bunch. So because of this compact bunch, the berries don't get space to enlarge the size. That's why the size of the berry is very small. Also because of the compaction, there is chances of fungal infection. So when we provide gibberellin to the untreated bunch of grapes, there is sudden increase in the length of the stalk, and because of the increase in length of the stalk, the size of the berry gets enlarged, because they get space to enlarge the size of the berry. Also because of the enlarged stalk length, longer stalk length, there is space for aeration, and because of the aeration, there is the chances of fungal infection get reduced, and that's why the grapes become fit for long distance transportation. Now the next important role of gibberellin is that it regulates sex expression in flowers, in sex expression of flowers, especially in mage. It promotes pistillate flowers. What happens? Mage has two type of flower, that is, these are the tassels, male flower, and these are the pistillate flower. So when we apply gibberellin, it suppresses the stamen development, and that's why it promotes the female flower, pistillate flower. When we apply gibberellin, then what happens? There is 100-fold increase in the level of gibberellin in the plant, and it reduces the stamen development or staminate flower. It suppresses the staminate flower, and that's why the pistillate flower, the number of pistillate flower increases. If the pistillate flower gets promoted. While in case of cucumber, it promotes male flower. Generally, gibberellin promotes male flower. Exception is in case of mage or beans, it causes, or in castor, it causes the formation of pistillate flowers. Here you can see there are two types of flower in cucumber. These are the male flower and these are the female flower. How will you differentiate the male flower and the female flower? See, here are the budding fruits in the female flower. So if you see the budding fruits in the female flower, this means that these are the female flower and these are the staminate flower. So gibberellin promotes male flower in case of cucumber, while female flower in case of male. Next important role of gibberellin is it induces parthenocarpy in pome and stone fruits where auxin fail to induce parthenocarpy. So in case of cherries, apple, plums, auxin has not much role, while gibberellin induces parthenocarpy in these fruits. Also, gibberellin improves the shape of delicious type apple, and it has not much effect on yield and taste, but it only improves the shape. Now, the one of the important commercial application of anti-gibberellin means the inhibitor of gibberellin biosynthesis, that is cycloseal, triple C. It prevents lodging in cereal. So what is lodging? So lodging means when there is rain or high wind speed, then the rains get accumulated in the head of the cereal, and due to weight of the water droplets, the plant falls off, and it causes very difficulty during harvesting. So lodging is the bending over of the stem near the ground level of grain crops, which make them very difficult to harvest and can dramatically reduce yield. So lodging in cereal is often a result of combined effect of inadequate standing power of the crop and the conditions such as rain, wind and hail. So when we apply cycloseal, it is mainly lodging takes place in tall varieties. So we generally shorten the length of the internode by providing the anti-gibberellin, that is inhibitor of gibberellin biosynthesis, that is cycloseal. Cycloseal reduces the stem elongation, and the plant becomes short and sturdy, and therefore it doesn't fall off, and that's why the lodging is prevented. So this is one of the important practical application of anti-gibberellin. Also, not only in cereals, but in case of the plants which are growing in glass house or poly house, it is very much difficult to manage the tall plants. That's why we require the desirable trait is the short plants, means short and sturdy plants in glass house can be easily managed. Therefore, we provide the inhibitor or anti-gibberellin inhibitor of gibberellin biosynthesis to prepare dwarf plant which can be easily managed in the glass house or poly house. Now, this slide I have already explained. Means gibberellin, important commercial application of gibberellin is that it increases the yield of sugar and yield of sugar cane. Thank you.